Grace, mercy, and peace to you, God our Father, and our Lord and risen Savior, Jesus Christ. When you fast, Jesus says, don't be like the hypocrites. When you fast, not if you fast. Jesus says this in the Sermon on the Mount. By the way, everyone's favorite good teachings of Jesus that maybe they've never actually read. Because once you read it, you realize Jesus isn't such a good teacher. He's a slave-driving taskmaster here in the Sermon on the Mount. I mean, sure, the Beatitudes are nice, maybe, until he starts talking about the law, and he warns the disciples not to relax the law, but even one tiny dot. So to avoid relaxing the law, Jesus launches into a sixfold intensification of the law, saying, you have heard that it was said of old, but I say to you, like you've heard it said of old, you should not murder, but I say to you, if you've even been angry with your brother, you already committed murder in your heart. And after you hear six of those come down, it's hard to imagine that anyone could be such a legalist. Such a hard-nosed dictator with the commandments. And that comes to a head in this statement of just how well you need to keep the commandments. He concludes this section by saying, you therefore must be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. And then, basically, right after that, right after Jesus telling us that we must be as perfect as his Father, comes our passage for this evening. Where he says, when you give to the needy, and when you pray, and when you fast, don't be like the hypocrites. Now, prayer we can get behind. We pray all the time. Maybe giving to the poor, too. But fasting is just weird. It seems too physical to be spiritual. It seems too concerned with what you eat or don't eat to be a Christian activity. Weight Watchers clients, maybe. Christians, no. Not Lutheran Christians, anyway. Not people liberated from the law, basking in the glorious freedom of the gospel, having severed their ties with the worst righteous earthly ticket to paradise Roman Catholics of the Middle Ages. And yet there are those words of Jesus, when you fast, he said. Later in the Gospel of Matthew, when the disciples of John the Baptist come to see Jesus and ask why they fasted, and the Pharisees fasted, but Jesus' disciples did not fast. Jesus answered, can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? The day will come, he says, when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. Then they will fast. After Jesus, the bridegroom, is taken away from them, after he is ascended into heaven, sitting at the right hand of God, like today, now. When you fast, Jesus said. Fasting, of course, involves hunger. Fasting means abstaining, not just from diet sodas or chocolate bars for 40 days, but from food. Properly done, fasting leaves your belly aching for another helping. This is why fasting seems too physical. For what does a rumbling belly have to do with your piety, with your Christian devotion? Behold, the man. This is our theme for this Lent. Behold the man. Jesus, the God-man, as Pontius Pilate trotted out before the jeering crowd, a freshly flawed Jesus wearing a diadem designed to inflict pain and suffering, and a fake royal robe intended to invite ridicule, Pontius Pilate preached an unintentional and yet profound sermon. He said, behold, In Jesus, God is man. The Word has become flesh like you. God is your brother. The one begotten of the Father from all eternity is now the one born of the Virgin Mary. And your Lord. Behold the man. Just like you, he has skin and bones, blood vessels and lymph nodes, teeth and hair, heart and lungs, blood and saliva, hands and feet, eyes and lips, tongue, stomach, spleen and joints. Behold the man. He eats, he breathes, he walks, he sleeps, he prays, he weeps, he laughs. He bleeds, he dies, he rises, he ascends, he sits, and he will come again. He is completely human and completely God. Two perfect natures in one indivisible person. He has fingerprints and a DNA. Behold the man, Jesus, your brother. Unlike us, though, he has no sin. His human nature is perfect, unspoiled by Adam's rebellion in the Garden of Eden. Because of sin, we are actually less than human. But not Jesus. Oh, he was tempted in every way, as we are, just like we are. Yet he is without sin. His desires are never distorted into lust, greed, coveting, or idolatry of any kind. Behold, the man. Like perfect Adam was at the close of the first day of paradise and the sixth day of creation, when God declared his handiwork to be very good, Jesus is as human as humans can be. As human as he intends to make you, by the way, in the resurrection. So why fast? Behold the man. Jesus fasted. The gospel for this coming Sunday places Jesus in the wilderness right after his baptism, fasting for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. This is not the fake fasting of feasting on fried fish or giving him some pet vice for the season. For 40 days, Jesus ate nothing. Matthew and Luke simply say he was hungry after 40 days. Seems like an understatement. You know, though, it shouldn't be noteworthy to say that God hadn't eaten for 40 days. Because eating is not something that's natural to God. God doesn't need to eat. But behold the man. Behold the God who took on human flesh in the virgin womb of a Jewish girl. Behold the unborn baby being nourished for 9 months in his temporary earthly throne room. Behold the crying infant. Rooting for the breast to fill his newborn stomach. Behold the toddler, to whom his parents introduced new foods, all of which he himself had created. Behold the boy, eating the Passover lamb with his extended family, which foreshadows his own death. Behold the man, God in human flesh, who needs to eat in order to live. And now, behold, the man who has not eaten for 40 days, 960 hours, 57,600 minutes, it's a long time to not eat. Behold, the man, the incarnate God with lips and teeth and tongue and taste buds that have not savored a morsel for 40 days. With an esophagus and stomach and intestines that have been empty for and aching for 40 days. Behold the man who fasts for you. before enduring an onslaught of temptation withstanding every one of them. Behold, the man who fasts and assumes that his disciples will also fast. You know, like fasting, Lent is weird. I mean, who has time or patience for a season of repentance, for subdued joy, for bottling up our alleluias until we can uncork them and get punched drunk with Easter jubilation? Who wants to explain to the Wednesday evening bridge club that they won't be around for the next 6 weeks? Who wants to give away more money to the poor from their already penny-pinched budgets? Who wants to devote more time for prayer from their way too busy schedules? Who wants to have dirty ashes smeared onto their foreheads? But that's what we do during Lent. Because Lent is weird. Lent, like fasting, is also oddly physical. In fact, the Germans call this penitential season before Easter Fastenzeit, fasting time. The disciplines of Lent, prayer, fasting, almsgiving, are designed to guard you against the age-old temptation of being too spiritual. It's a temptation that's as old as creation. When the serpent seduced Adam and his wife to give in to the spiritual desire to be like God, knowing good and evil, over the physical prohibition against eating from that one tree, they set the pattern for the rest of us, who'd rather focus on being more spiritual. So once God settled the Israelites into the promised land, they quickly abandoned the very physical worship of Yahweh alone in Jerusalem by sacrificing to him in the temple for the more spiritual, less precise worship of the Baals and the Asherah. Nicodemus cracked a joke that the true religion can never be so physical to involve rebirth. And the Sadducees concocted their ridiculous story about a woman who married one of seven brothers to prove that the physical resurrection was not possible. And your children, who insist they're spiritual but not religious, and you give your amen when your friends tell you you don't have to go to church to be a Christian. All of that is an attempt to substitute safer spiritual platitudes for real, physical, fleshly realities. And it's all sin. You want to give something up for Lent? We should give up our pious, hyper-spiritual pretensions. Because God isn't God. The Incarnation has been in his mind from before the first words of creation. Behold, the man. In Jesus, in whom the fullness of God dwells bodily. You have both a body and the complete inability to use it properly as your Creator intended. You can have hope. God is like this, a man, your brother. Behold the man. Jesus fasted for you. He is a God who can eat, a God who needs to eat so that he can abstain from eating, enduring the pains of hunger to deny his flesh what it desires for you. For your tendency to prefer the spiritual over the physical and a fake spirituality that leads you to indulge in the flesh of its desires, both good and evil. Jesus endured temptation and never sinned so that he could be the man to redeem all other men, the Creator who would ransom his creatures, God who could give his life for sinners, for you. So fast. Fast to chasten and discipline your flesh. Fast so that you, as you learn to control your belly, it will give you discipline to control the other parts of your flesh as well. Fast and let the rumbling hunger teach you that your belly is not your God. Pray until you realize that your schedule is not your God, your time is not your own, and the daily bread does not come from the work of your own hands. Give alms, tithe, give offerings, and give money until you know down in your gut that money is not the source of your security or your happiness. Behold the man who fasted, prayed, and gave alms perfectly for you. His rumbling stomach, his hunger pains are your comfort in temptation. His flesh is your hope. He succeeded where you have failed. Behold the man. And then, break the fast. Eat, drink. At his altar, filled with bread and wine, so for his disciples to eat and drink for the forgiveness of their sins, with his flesh as true food, and his blood as true drink. Behold the man. Let the growling of your belly in Lent at any time lead you here, to the place where the Lord bids you to fast and to hunger no more. Here is the food that endures to eternal life. Drink that quenches your deepest thirst. Here at his altar is the man who gives himself to you to eat and to drink for the forgiveness of your sins, for the strengthening of your faith, for the enabling of your fervent love for one another.